First, I should say this is some work with Tobias Weitsch and Joachim Hilliard. And this is based on some techniques or works that I did with before with. Diatlov and Four. So the the problem is to describe the spectrum of the geodesic flow for certain hyperbolic manifold, and it fits in a little in a way in the conference, because in this case actually the evolution is just the flow, the geodesic flow, and the space really where the dynamics happens is a kind of fractal set, so it's kind of singular. But because we don't really know how to do a dynamic on fractal set, at least let's say spectral theory and things like this, it's not so easy. We use a different approach, so we view the fractal set inside a smooth manifold, and this fractal set is an invariant set for the dynamic. So let me explain the model. So I'll take H2 will be the hyperbolic plane. And I will view it as the disk in C, the unit disk. With the metric dz square one minus z square square, this will be the hyperbolic metric. It's curvature minus one. So you have a group acting which is SU11, but which is isomorphic to PSL2R. PSL2R really would act on the half space model of hyperbolic plane, which is conformally equivalent to this and actually isometric to this for the hyperbolic metric, which in this model would be dz square over imaginary part of z square. And it acts as isometries on H2, which preserve the orientation. But in fact, you can also view PSL2R as a subgroup of PSL2C, and PSL2C act on the sphere. So it will be convenient to also consider the Riemann sphere, where you can view H2, which I will put a plus, because in fact, in the unit sphere, you have two copies of H2. And the equator is just the boundary here, or the real line in this model. And PSL2R, as I said, can be viewed as a subgroup of PSL2C, which acts as conformal transformation and preserving the equator. Which is the real line, MZ equals zero. So now I will consider some discrete group it will be a Fuchsian group. And I will assume that there exists a fundamental domain for the action of the group. With finitely many sides. So we say in this case that the group is geometrically finite. And I will also assume that gamma contain only hyperbolic transformation. That any gamma in the group is hyperbolic. So it means that it has two fixed points. In what I will call H2 bar, which is just the compactification, the closed unit disk. And the group acts, of course, smoothly up to the disk because, in fact, it acts on the Riemann sphere. And you have two fixed points, so let's say, for instance, one here and one here. You have a geodesic. Which is a half circle orthogonal to the boundary. And the transformation acts as a hyperbolic translation along the geodesic. One fixed point is attractive, the other one is repulsive. And I assume that all the elements are hyperbolic. In this case, we say that the group is convex co-compact. So in particular, there is no elliptic transformation, which will have fixed point inside the H2, and we also assume that there is no parabolic transformation, and those one are the transformation which have one point fixed on the boundary, on the circle. So gamma is called convex co-compact. So now let's consider the quotient. I will denote M the quotient. So the group acts properly discontinuously. With no fixed point on the inside. So the quotient is going to be a smooth manifold, which inherit a hyperbolic metric from just the metric of H2, because gamma are isometries. I will also assume that gamma is not a co-compact group. So it's not co-compact, which means that the quotient is not compact. Okay. So let me just remind for those who are not so familiar with this type of geometry, the geometric type of the quotient. So the geometry of M in this case, it's quite simple actually. You can decompose geometrically your surface into a compact surface with geodesic boundary, which I will call M0, which is the convex core. and some funnels, infinite funnels like this. So this one is compact with geodesic boundary. And each FI, is isometric to a funnel. And a funnel is just a half cylinder. So I use the variable T for the distance to the geodesic. Li and across a circle of length Li. And the metric is dt square plus cosh t to the square times d theta square, where theta is just the variable here. So that's quite simple. So, for instance, an example, you can take a free group generated by two elements. Two hyperbolic transformations, be a Schottky group, which send one geodesic to another, like this, for instance. And here the same. It's one geodesic on the other. And here you have a fundamental domain, so it would send the outside of this half disk to the inside of here, and conversely, and same here. So you have this will be a fundamental domain, which I'll denote by F. And if you copy this three disk by some of the elements, you get three more here, three more here. So here you have another fundamental domain. And when you continue like this, you, at the end, you get a tessellation of hyperbolic space. So you get something like this at the end. So one thing is that M can be compactified smoothly, actually. And the way you can view this is that, in fact, gamma act, in fact, on C bar minus a set which I will denote lambda. And lambda is the limit set of the group. It will be an important thing in what follows. So the limit set, it's a subset of S1. Which is defined by you take all the possible, so you fix a point in the fundamental domain, Z0, and you look at the orbit by the group generated by these elements, and this converge to this point when you replicate by all the elements of the group. It converges to a certain kind of fractal set, so it will be defined like this. Here, of course, I see the half disk, if you want. When I look at the action on C-bar, I see the half disk as the upper half sphere as I drew before. So it will be this. Gamma, that zero is a fixed, is a given point. And I take all the elements of the group, and I intersect with S1, which is the boundary, and I take the closure. S1, I view it as the boundary of H2 bar, and in the model of the sphere, it's just the equator. Okay. So in fact, gamma act on this space properly discontinuously. As a complex transformation. And the quotient is a compact surface. It's a compact Riemann surface. Which I will denote by M square. So I take the quotient of the action of gamma on this space. And in fact, M square is nothing more than the double, if you want, of M, in a way, glued at infinity. So you have two copies, M here. This is the infinity of M, if you want, and they are glued. And because the action is just by a smooth conformal transformation, this provides compactification, which is just the half of this space. And this space will be important, actually, in what I describe. So on this space, M square, you have an involution, which is just Z done Z bar. You see, because on the Riemann sphere, you have the complex conjugation, and it descends on this space because the group gamma was acting on PSL2R, so it acts essentially the same way here and here by conjugation. Okay. so it's good to. To see what's the smooth structure near the boundary where we glue. So for this, it's convenient to use the function exponential minus t in the funnel, in the funnels, fj. And if you rewrite the metric using this coordinate, you get something like this. So I'll write it this way, actually. H naught time so much one plus some constant that you can compute the square to the square. And H naught is just the d theta square metric. On the boundary. Okay, so C is a constant that you can compute maybe it's 1/4 or something. So the metric is the hyperbolic metric is conformal to a smooth metric. It's conformally compact in the sense of Matzmann-Rose and Pfefferman-Graham. So G is conformally compact. It's conformal to a smooth. Conformal to a smooth metric because if you multiply by rho square, you find a smooth metric up to the boundary, which extends actually to M square. It's seven symmetric in this case. Okay. So now let me come to the geodesic flow on this space. So I will denote it by phi t. Phi t is a flow which acts on the unit tangent bundle. Sm is the unit tangent bundle, so the set of point and speed in Tm where g of v is 1. It's the energy shell. And phi t is generated by a vector field, which I will denote x. Okay, it's a flow of a vector field, which is the vector field of the geodesic flow. So you can see that geodesics in M lift to H2, to the universal covering. And in this picture, each geodesic on the quotient, you can lift it, and it produces a certain geodesic on H2. So in fact, the geodesic flow, you can also view it as just the geodesic flow on H2, but considering the action of the group, like you will do in the torus, for instance. Okay. So there are some important quantities. One is the trap set for the flow. So I will denote it by K. So K will be the set of points in SM such that phi t of xv belong to SM0 for any t. So in particular, you see that the base point needs to be in M0, this convex score. So this would be the set of points and direction where you never escape to infinity in both directions. Another quantity which I need to define is the trap set in the future, which I will define like this. Sorry, it will be in the, yeah, my notation is a bit confusing, but lambda plus is trapped in the past, actually. So it means that geodesic do not escape when you flow backward. So it means that phi t of xv is belonging to m0 for t negative and t large enough. Okay. So for instance, a point here and this direction here, if you flow backward, there is a possibility that then, after some time, it stays in the region M0. In this case, we will say that this is in lambda plus. And lambda minus would be the same, but which is trapped in the future. So in fact, when you look at the covering, it's quite simple to see what are these sets. So if you consider H2 or H2 bar, For each point x and v, if you take the geodesic, which is tangent to xv, it's going to be something like this. So you can associate the endpoint on the boundary, which I will denote b plus xv, and the endpoint in the past, which I will denote by b minus xv. So b plus and minus will be mapped from sh2 to s1, just the forward endpoint and the backward endpoint. So what I claim is that lambda plus, in fact, it's direct to C, if I lift it, so lambda plus minus is just p gamma star of lambda plus minus, where p gamma is just the covering map from the unit tangent bundle of H2 to SM. It's nothing more than, so these are trajectory trapped in the past, and being trapped in the past, in fact, means that when you go backward, you will not, you will end up in the limit set. Because the complement of the limit set, if you want, correspond to infinity after the quotient. So this is b minus minus 1 of the limit set of the group. Okay? And the same, if I put a minus here, I have to put a plus here. And k is just k, if I lift it to SH2, it's just going to be the intersection of the two. So k would correspond to trajectories. This one does not go up, no? It can? The okay. So in fact, because the limit set is a fractal set, you can see that k and lambda plus or minus are actually also fractal set. B minus is a submersion. And by using B minus and B plus, you can see that in fact, the unit tangent bundle of H2 correspond essentially to pair of points at the boundary time the real line, and the real line is essentially the coordinate along the geodesic. Okay, just a remark that SH2 is isomorphic to S1 times S1 minus the diagonal time R, where the first coordinate is B plus, the second is B minus, and R, for instance, could be the distance of the point to the origin of the hyperbolic space. So let me just make my picture. So for instance, one geodesic going from an element of the limit set here to here will be in lambda, it will be in lambda plus, and if I take the point on the geodesic and the tangent vector, will be in lambda plus, lambda plus, and the lambda minus would be something trapped in the future. So, for instance, something like this, some trajectory like this. So now I need to introduce a little bit more thing about the geometry of the unit tangent bundle. So K is compact here. It's compact. If I consider pi naught, the projection from SM to M, projection on the base, the projection of K is actually included in M naught, the convex core. Now, the flow on SM is hyperbolic, actually. So it has the Anosov property. What it means? It means that you can decompose the tangent space into the flow direction. Ru minus and Ru plus. So U minus and U plus are vector field on SM. And U minus would be the unstable direction. And U plus would be the stable direction. And these vector fields have the properties that when you look at the differential of the flow in the stable direction and you propagate forward, it will contract exponentially fast. So U plus and minus have the property that when you commute with the vector field of the geodesic flow, you get this relation. And in fact, if you, because this property is in a way a local property, it suffices to look at what happened on SH2. And on SH2, there is a natural isomorphism between SH2 and the group SL2, just by, if you take an element gamma in SL2, you associate the point gamma of zero. You see gamma are just... or just transformation like this in the disk. Maybe I need one half. So four, yes, one half probably. E1. And E1 is just d over dx. If you write a z as x plus. So you, for each group, for each element of the group, you associate the image of zero. Take zero. You look at where it maps by the group. And you look at the image of the vector E1, and you can see that it's an isomorphism. So looking at the dynamics, in fact, is just looking at the dynamic of a certain vector field on SH2. And what are x, u minus, and u plus? They're given by these formulas, by the usual formulas. X is just, it's an element in the, you can see it as a, an element in the Lie algebra SL2R as a left invariant vector field. And U plus is nothing more than zero, and U minus is nothing more as 0, 1, 0. So you also have the commutation relation, U plus U minus equal to X. So that's the geometry of the unit tangent bundle. So in fact, what are U plus and U minus doing? If you take their flow, these are vector fields, you can take their flow, and these are just what are called the horocyclic flow. So exponential t U plus is the stable horocyclic flow. So you take a point, a direction v, you look at the endpoint, b plus, consider the horosphere, take the normal bundle to the horosphere, and exponential t u plus will move this point xv to one of the point on the unit on the conormal bundle, and we'll move it at distance t. So it moves along the stable manifold. So this horocyclic flow is very important for the properties of the geodesic flow, actually, because it has certain, you see, from this thing, it has a certain commutation relation which make which somehow contribute to the spectral theory of X. So let me now go to resonance, now that I have the... So Ruelle resonance. So this is something that we showed with Semyon Dyatlov. In fact, in a much more general case of the setting of axiom A flow, for axiom A flow, but this case is actually a special case of axiom A flow. So we show that if you take F1, F2, two compactly supported smooth function on SM, and you see in dynamics what people are interested in are what they call the correlation. So the correlation of the flow X associated to the pair of function. This is defined as just the integral on SM of F1 of phi t y product with phi 2 y d mu y. So I forgot to say that, in fact, there is a natural measure, which is called the Liouville measure on SM, which I will denote by mu L. And this measure is invariant by the flow. So if you take the Lie derivative of mu L is zero. And in fact, it's also invariant by u plus. Okay. So if I define this correlation for t, you want to describe the long time behavior when t go to infinity, for instance, to describe the mixing and so on. So if I define the Laplace transform so we'll denote it R x lambda F1 F2. So I take it like this, it's more or less the Laplace transform, but I integrate in a backward time. So it's exponential lambda t cx f1 f2 t dt. So real part of lambda negative. You see that this converge when real part, positive. You see that it converges when the real part is positive, because the flow preserves the measure. In fact, this Rx of lambda F1, F2 admits a meromorphic extension to the complex plane. And the poles are called the real resonance. They do not depend on F1, F2. Rx lambda F1 F2 admits a meromorphic extension to see. The poles are called the Ruelle resonance. Independent of F1, F2, actually. I mean, well, not quite. And the polar part is of the form, the polar part at a pole. Is of the form Rx lambda. So really, you can view this Rx lambda as the resolvent, in fact, acting on F1 scalar product with F2. It's minus the sum J lambda naught J pi lambda naught over lambda naught J. And pi lambda naught is a finite rank projector on a certain space. It's a finite rank operator mapping two distributions. And the elements in the range are called generalized resonance state. Sorry, I forgot to say, this is this. Applied to F1 and paired with F2. So. So there is the generalized resonance state. This is just the range of pi lambda naught at lambda naught, the Ruelle resonance. It has the property that x actually commutes with pi naught. And in fact, x plus lambda naught is nilpotent on this space. So you see when big J is bigger than one, you have Jordan blocks, actually, for this operator, which you can view as a matrix on this finite dimensional space. And how to characterize a resonance, a generalized resonance state? So U is actually in the range of pi lambda naught if and only if there exists a J such that x plus lambda naught JU is zero, so it's a generalized eigenfunction. And the wavefront set of U is included in EU star. So EU star is characterized by the fact that it vanishes on the flow. It's a subset of T star of SM. And it vanishes on U minus. So it's the annihilator of the weak and stable direction. So the condition is this. And the third thing is that the support of U is included in lambda plus, in the backward trap set. So this is the complete characterization of what is a generalized resonance state, actually. So just one lemma now. How much time I have?
5 minutes.
Sorry?
5 minutes.
There is a lemma which says that, in fact, if U is in the range of pi lambda naught, there exists M such that U minus of U is zero when you raise it to the M. And the idea is quite simple. It's just that you apply U minus to U because of the fact that X U minus has this commutation relation that I wrote before. In fact, you see that U minus of U would be a generalized resonance state, but for the resonance, lambda not plus one. And if you do it enough time, you enter in the physical plane, so you know that it does not exist. So in fact, using this, we can really characterize the resonance state as a distribution U on SM, so that x plus lambda naught to the j is zero for some j. U minus U to some m is zero. And this is sufficient because by ellipticity, you directly get the wavefront set condition if you have this. So this is really the characterization of Ruelle resonance state. So now what we can show is we can really describe what are these resonances. So for this, I need one theorem, which was due to Mazel Maros and Guillaume Petzvorsky. Which is that so if you take the Laplacian on M and you take the resolvent of the Laplacian with a certain parameter, so this is a bounded operator on L2. In fact, R delta MS, when you evaluate on F1 and make the product with F2, just as before, when F1 and F2 are compactly supported function, but this time on M, not on SM, then this thing extends meromorphically to S in C. And exactly like I explained here, the poles the polar part of the pole of finite trunk operator, they have the same kind of decomposition here, but instead of x, essentially you get the Laplacian. So maybe I don't state everything because I'm a bit short in time. But the polar part has finite trunk. And the element in the range of the residue of R delta M at S equals S0 are called generalized quantum resonance state. Okay, so let me just state the theorem and then I'll be done. So what we show is the following. If lambda naught is not in 1/2 minus F not, if it's not a half integer, then one has the push forward map, which take distribution on SM to distribution on M. So push forward map is just the dual of the pullback. By pi zero, remember, is the projection on the base. The dual to the pullback act on smooth function. This restrict to an isomorphism uh, as a map from so it will be kernel of X plus lambda dot J on the range of pi lambda naught intersect with kernel of U minus to kernel of delta M minus S naught 1 minus S naught to the J on the range of pi S naught, where pi S naught is just the residue of the quantum, I mean, the resolvent of the Laplacian. And pi lambda naught is just a residue, maybe minus the residue of Rx at lambda naught. And S naught is equal to lambda naught plus 1. So this gives, for this point, a correspondence between a generalized Ruelle resonance state and a quantum resonance state. Now, if I take the point 1 half minus 1 half minus k, and then I'm finished. Sorry. Minus 1 half minus k. There are no resonance, actually. Minus n with n integer. There are no Ruelle and quantum resonance. And there remains just the integer point now, the negative integer, at lambda naught equal minus n. What we can show is that there is a certain map, which I don't have the time to define, unfortunately, but which I will denote Pn star, which map the same thing as before, care of, actually, in this case, there is no Jordan block. So I just need to, no Jordan block, so I just need to take j equal 1. And it just map care of x minus n on pi minus n, on the range of pi minus n, pi n star. And it map not to quantum resonance, but to a certain space hn. And what is HN? HN is a set of holomorphic sections of the canonical bundle on M square, on the double of M. So HN is just the set of F restricted on M bar, where F is a smooth section on M2 the power n of the canonical bundle. Bundle on M square. So M square is a complex surface, such that d bar of f is zero, and I star of f is f bar. So these are the space of holomorphic section of the canonical bundle on M square, which are symmetric with respect to the natural involution. In a way, you can view this, if you know the Schwarz reflection principle, as a section which are real-valued on the boundary. This is finite dimensional space. We can compute its dimension by Riemann-Rohr. And I think I stop here. No, they don't. They don't come. They don't have relation with the Laplacian. If you want, here what you do, you pi zero star is just the integration in the fibers. So it's really you integrate along the constant function in the fiber of the perturbation. And here what you do, you don't if you integrate if you take the push forward, actually you get zero. And what you have to do, you have to integrate again the n Fourier or the minus n Fourier mod in the fiber, like exponential minus I n theta. And this map to this. Yes.
So the hypotheses will matter more general than just the convex hood impact.
Yes.
Said it has just actually been closed, right?
You mean when the theorem it works in a quite general case actually. We need a sort of manifold with boundary with a certain flow on it. Not necessarily complete. We assume that the boundary is strictly convex with respect to the flow. And there is a certain set inside which we call trap set, which are the set of trajectory which never touch the boundary. And the assumption we ask is that the dynamic on K is hyperbolic, so has the Anosov decomposition. And that's essentially all what we need to get this sort of result.
Let's have Colin take further questions over lunch.